In this video lecture, we'll make some final updates to our Person class by adding some last utility methods which will let our class do some person-specific things. Okay, let's get started. We've already built up our Person class by putting into place the various standard methods common to most any class. Things like constructors, accessors and mutators, display methods, and an equals method. But classes typically also have other utility methods which provide what is sometimes called the business logic of a class. These are the public methods that provide services of the class to any outside client code and make a class do whatever that class is supposed to do. There might also be some private utility methods not intended for outside use, but merely for the internal private use of the class. For example, in my CS12 date class, there's also a method which determines the number of days in any month, but it's private and not intended for outside use. As far as API documentation goes, only the public methods are part of the class API. You usually won't find any private methods listed in an API, but you would find private methods listed on a UML class diagram because that's intended as documentation for the designer to implement. We're going to finish up implementing our Person class by considering two types of utility methods, derived data accessors, and a couple other utility methods specific to our Person class that let our Person class objects do person things. As a refresher, here's our Person class API one last time. By this point, we've implemented everything through the end of this green section, with the exception of this one last update method, and also this equals method. What we're looking at now is finishing up this Person class by implementing these three derived data accessors in purple and these last two utility methods in light brown. Before going any further, let's first define what we mean by base versus derived data in our Person class. For us, base data simply refers to the instance variables of some class. This is the core handful of data which, as designers of the class, we've decided adequately describes any objects of that class. This is generally data that can be directly obtained or measured, and this is data which can be directly manipulated using the accessors and mutators of a class. For example, suppose we were designing a car class. Our instance variables might include things like the miles, which we can read from the odometer, or the gallons of gas added, which we could read at the gas pump. For our Person class, we decided that two of our instance variables would be height and weight, which obviously we can directly measure, and the birth date, which would be known or specified. By contrast, derived data is that which is calculated or derived from other more basic data. In our car class example, we wouldn't directly specify miles per gallon, we would calculate it from the miles divided by the gallons. For our Person class, we're going to consider three items of derived data: age, IQ, and BMI, or body mass index. We don't simply set the age, we derive it from the birth date. And oh, by the way, don't we already have a utils method which calculates this for us? For the IQ, we're going to make the design assumption that a person's IQ is some function of their age, which as we just said is derived from their birth date. Finally, for the BMI, that's just a standard medical definition that's calculated from the height and weight together. In typical usage, as we already know, we provide both public accessors and mutators for our private instance variables, or base data. However, we would only provide public accessors for any derived data, simply because we would recalculate it upon demand from any other base data, anytime we need to get it. Because derived data is recalculated on the fly from the more basic instance variables, it doesn't need to become additional new instance variables, simply from a data maintenance standpoint. If we wanted our derived data to become new instance variables, we then assume the responsibility to recalculate it any time any of its constituent base data changes. For example, if we made BMI an extra instance variable, we'd have to recalculate it every time the height changed or every time the weight changed. And we really don't want to do that. We prefer to freshly recalculate BMI any time it's needed and save ourselves the hassle of maintaining it. Down here on the right are the three derived data accessors we're going to implement for our Person class. Note that like any well-behaved accessors, their names are all going to begin with a standard get, and also notice that there are accessors only and no accompanying mutators. For the getAge accessor, this one is simple. We're just going to use our existing getAgeUtils method given a birth date. And notice that the birth date here is our CS12 date instance variable. so no inputs to this method are needed. For the IQ, we're going to make a huge assumption that pretty much everyone is born bright with a starting IQ of 100 at birth, and adding one IQ point for every year of age thereafter. Now, this is just a purely made-up assumption, and you might substitute your own calculation for this. In fact, my two teen and preteen kids might think this is nuts, because to them I'm probably dropping IQ points each time I wake up. But this is just a made-up calculation to get this code working. So for the GetIQ accessor, we simply return the sum of this base value of 100 plus the age, which of course we can get by calling this previous method. As for the body mass index, or BMI, it's calculated according to this well-documented equation, and conveniently our instance variables for height and weight are already in these SI units. So finally, for the GetBMI accessor, we simply return the weight divided by the height squared, and we also add this if-else check to prevent a divide by zero error, which could possibly occur given that our default constructor sets a default value for height of 0. Again, notice that because height and weight are instance variables and available to every method in this class, there's no need to pass them in to this method as input parameters. So there we have it, our three derived data accessors, and each one calculates its return value freshly upon demand. Because each of these methods returns one scalar value of their respective data types, we can use these method names to refer to the data quantities of age, IQ, and BMI. And as we see up here, we'll then add these three derived data values to our print method. And notice how each method call is itself equivalent to the age, IQ, and BMI, respectively. We'll also make use of this format specifier earlier in the class to print all body-related data with two decimal places. Notice also that we chose not to add the derived data to our two-string output, preferring to display only the true six instance variables, but that's just a designer's choice. In either display method, notice how we've laid this out to have one piece of data on each line, which makes it very easy to reorder these outputs or add new data later on. That's just for ease of code maintenance. You can find all these refinements to our Person class as the Person Phase 10.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view at this point. Next, here are the two utility methods we're going to implement for our Person class. A utility method simply represents some class-specific action that is provided for in the API. Again, just like we did for the IQ, we're going to make some very simple assumptions for the purposes of illustration. We're going to assume that objects of our Person class, at a bare minimum, can eat and exercise. Obviously, there are many more things we could potentially design for, but hopefully these two will get the point across adequately. We're going to make the following very made-up assumptions. For the eat method, a person's weight increases by 0.1 kilogram per 1,000 food calories ingested. And for the exercise method, a person's weight decreases by 0.1 kilogram per 1 hour of exercise. Oh, if it were only this simple, I'd be a much thinner man by now. Perhaps we could come up with more accurate calculations, but these are enough to get started, and we can update these later. So on the top right here are these two utility methods. The eat method is a void type. It returns no value to its caller. It simply takes as its input the number of calories ingested, then down here divides that by 1,000 and multiplies by 0.1, and then updates the weight instance variable accordingly. We can also do some input validity checking here by flagging the user if the input value is less than 0 and making no changes. The exercise method below it is similar. It's also a void method and returns no value to its caller. Instead, it multiplies the input hours of exercise by 0.1, then decreases the instance variable weight accordingly. Notice the use of arithmetic shortcut operators in both these equations, and a similar input validity check in this method. Here on the bottom is some test code we might use to test these two methods, with all the before and after output on the right. Your actual results may vary depending upon what your test code has set the object P2 to by this point, but this gets the point across. First, we print the before state of the object so that we see what the starting weight is. Then, this person consumes 1,000 calories, and we see that their weight has gone up by the expected 0.1 kilograms. Then, this person hits the gym and exercises for 2 hours, so the weight drops by 0.2 kilograms, as we see in the final result. But not only that, notice that the BMI has been adjusted accordingly as well. going up slightly for the weight gain, then dropping back down after exercising. Remember that BMI is being recalculated every time we call its derived data accessor, so we see those calculations working properly also. You can find all these refinements to our person class as the person phase 10.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view at this point. Finally, here's one final utility method we'll add to our person class, one which will allow us to update all the instance variables of a person object at once. We'll call this our update method, and it takes as its one input a Boolean input mode flag. This method simply groups together individual calls to all of the instance variable prompting mutators using the same input mode flag that was provided. So in this test code, we're creating a new person object P6 with all default plain vanilla instance variables. Then we turn right around and apply the update method to it, and we indicate that we'll use the false or scanner mode for inputs. And then the user is prompted for update values for all of the instance variables. We follow that up with a print of our updated object, and we see that all our data has been updated as desired. As a side benefit, notice that by calling this one update method, we are effectively also testing all of our prompting mutators at the same time. As a final observation, for any Big Bang Theory fans out there, I think we can probably agree that Sheldon Cooper's IQ is grossly underestimated here. So yeah, we might want to update that IQ calculation after all, but not now. You can find all these last refinements to our person class as the person phase 10.java snapshot, along with the associated code walkthrough which goes over them, which I encourage you to view at this point. Also, take a look at all the test code which shows how to demonstrate that our final changes are working properly. Okay then, that represents our last major set of changes, and our person class should be nearing its final state by now.